I welcome all of you in Jesus' name. And for the past 2 weeks, we have been meditating on the topic of the Holy Spirit. Because on 23rd is the Pentecostal Sunday. So for the past 2 weeks, I spoke about the Holy Spirit keeping the word Luke chapter 3, verse 16. John the Baptist said, I baptize you with the water, but Jesus will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. So, Holy Spirit, if we are baptized with the Holy Spirit, we will have the nature of Jesus Christ. Or, last week I explained, the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Fruit of the Holy Spirit is very, very important for us to tell the world, to show the world that we are the true followers of Jesus Christ. And also explained the fruits of the evil spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 21, the fruit of the evil spirit, I explained. And also last week I explained fruit of the Holy Spirit, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So these are very, very important. So why we need the fruits of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit is this. Only the fruit of the Holy Spirit and gift of the Holy Spirit can be seen in you or in me or in the followers of Jesus Christ's life. That is how the world can be differentiated between the followers of true God, who belongs to true God, who belongs to God the Father, Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, and who does not belong to God the Father, Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So only these two things, fruit of the Holy Spirit and gift of the Holy Spirit. Because we follow Jesus and we have the nature of Jesus Christ. And today we are going to meditate about the fruit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The gifts are very, very, very important. Why the gifts of the Holy Spirit are very important? Because these gifts can operate only through Jesus and the followers of Jesus. Today, so many religious leaders are there in every religion. All these religious leaders can preach something good, but they will not have the gifts of the Holy Spirit. They cannot perform miracles. They cannot raise the dead. They cannot make the crippled to walk. They cannot make the blind to see. You know, these are the gifts which I am going to explain from the Word of God. So, gifts of the Holy Spirit is very, very important. That is what John the Baptist said. Jesus will baptize you with fire. The heavenly fire. When Mother Mary and the apostles and many other people, about 120 people, when they started praying for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we read it in Acts chapter 1 and 2. You know, the heavenly fire came and dwelt among them. It descended upon them in the form of tongues, the fiery tongues. So the fiery anointing is very, very important. And this kind of anointing can be received only by the followers of Jesus, only who believes in Jesus. So many religious leaders are there. All religious leaders of different religion cannot receive this anointing. Because they don't believe in Jesus. They don't follow in Jesus. They don't repent. They don't confess. They don't accept Jesus as the only Lord and God and Savior. So these gifts are very, very, very important. So we can read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 10. the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. At the same time, you can read in Romans chapter 12, 6 to 8, there are few more gifts. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, again, you'll find some more gifts of the Holy Spirit. In Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, you see some more gifts of the Holy Spirit. In Isaiah 11, 2 says, the gift of fear of God. Today, people have lost the fear of God in the world. Any man, any woman, or any country who loses the fear of God, and they will lose the sense of sin. Anything and everything is okay. Whatever they do is okay, okay, okay. But any man or any woman or any family, if they have the fear of God, they will have sense of sin. And they will be scared to commit a sin, even to tell lies. Even to cheat, even to loot, even to use bad words. They will have the fear. Oh my God, the Lord is looking at me. How can I use the fear? I use the bad words. How can I tell lies? How can I cheat? How can I loot? How can I commit sin? This is called the fear of God. This is one of the gifts. Today, people in this world needs this gift. Needs this gift. As the same Isaiah 11, 2 says, and also the gift of understanding. Understanding the plan of God and the plan of the devil. Today the plan of the devil is very, very interesting. All the plans of the devils are coming through movies, internet, and all kind of things we know. Very interesting. But any man who has got the gift of understanding through the plan of God, that man, that woman, that family, oh, they will reject the devil. They will reject the ways of the devil. They will reject the sin. Yes, these are very, very important gifts, brother. And also Romans chapter 12, verse 6 to 8, we read that the gift of mercy, amazing gift. Gift of generosity. Gift of love and compassion. How many of us have these gift of mercy or generosity or gift of love, gift of compassion? When we think of all this gift, we can remember one person in the world, that is Saint Mother Teresa. Oh, amazing personality. Mother Teresa had all this gift of mercy. Oh, she was moved with compassion and mercy and love toward the poorest of the poor. She used to pick up the roadside people, the destitutes, lepers. They may belong to any religion, any language. Mother Teresa used to never see whether they are Christians or non-Christian. And she used to see God in them. Pick them up and give them a decent life. If they die, a decent burial. Oh, these gifts. Romans chapter 12, verse 6 to 8, gift of mercy, gift of generosity, gift of love. Oh, Mother Teresa had. We all should have. We all should have this gift. And I was very close to Mother Teresa. And when Mother Teresa was alive, Mother used to invite me to give retreats to her sisters in Calcutta. That's one of the cities in India. And I was so close to Mother Teresa when I used to give retreat. Even Mother used to sit and listen. I am not at all worthy for that. A living saint, now a saint, listening to my words. I am not worthy. But look at the humility Mother had. And every time I used to go, my Mother used to tell me, oh, I pray for you. I pray for you. I'll pray for you. Even now, Mother will be praying for me, not only me, for all the people in this world. So, Romans 12, chapter 12, 6 to 8, the gift of mercy, gift of generosity, gift of love, gift of compassion. And in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, the gift of becoming an apostle. to become a prophet, to become an evangelist, to become a pastor, teachers of the word of God. Yes, brothers and sisters, these are all an amazing gift which comes from God. And the Holy Spirit is the one, the giver of the gift. That is why Jesus said, I will go to heaven to my Father. I will send the Holy Spirit. I will send you the Comforter. He will be with you. If you want to know more about the Holy Spirit, Gospel of John, chapter 14, chapter 15, and chapter 16, you read all these three chapters. And there you find a lot of points about the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said, I will send this Holy Spirit who will be a counselor, comforter, and he will live with you. He will be in you. These are the days we see children forsake the parents and go away. These are the days we see husband and wife are getting separated or divorced. And these are the days people cheat each other. But Jesus said, the Holy Spirit that comes and he will dwell in you. Praise God. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, Holy Spirit is very, very important. Without the help of the Holy Spirit, I cannot lead a holy life. You cannot lead a holy life. No one can lead a holy life in this world. That's why Jesus said, I will send you the Holy Spirit. Now, as John the Baptist said, now Jesus will baptize you with the fire. So what is this fire anointing? And that's what I said. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 10. We find 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. Or these gifts are the power of God. Only, as I told you, the followers of Jesus can receive it. Only believers of Jesus can receive it. Not any other people, not any other religious leaders. Only the follower of Jesus, who believes in Jesus, who thirst for Jesus. And these are the 9 gifts. And what are the 9 gifts? Speaking in tongues, and the gift of interpretation, gift of prophecy, gift of knowledge, gift of wisdom, gift of discernment, gift of faith, gift of healing, and gift of miracles. Amazing gift. No any other religious books in the world you can find this except the Bible. There are so many books about many religions. You can never find this. You can find only in the Holy Bible, because this is coming straight from heaven. God the Father, Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So for you to understand, for me to understand, I have classified these 9 gifts into 3 groups so that you can remember very well. So the 3 groups is that, the first group, I made it as the communication, divine communication between you and God. And revelation, that is knowledge, wisdom, and discernment. That is, God is revealing many things to you or through you. And the heavenly power, that is the faith, healing, and miracles. So let us now meditate about the first group. The first group is the, you know, tongues, gift of interpretation, and gift of prophecy. Gift of tongues. You know, gift of tongues. In the world, there are more than 6,000 languages, including dialect. In India itself, you have every village has got their own dialect. So many languages. And now in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1, and 1 Corinthians chapter 10, sorry, chapter 14, verse 10, the Bible says there are human languages. That is about 6,000 human languages, I said. Different people can speak different language. But today, in the name of language, if there is division, If there is fighting or enmity, that is the work of the devil. In the name of language, no one should fight. No language is important. Jesus is important. Every language is only to communicate. We should respect all human languages. And 1 Corinthians 13:1 says, even angels have their own language to communicate between themselves. Romans 8:26 says, even the Holy Spirit have their own way of communication. That's the language. My dear brothers and sisters, all these languages are important, and it's only for communication. So what is gift of tongues? The gift of tongues is this: you will be able to speak either an unknown human language or the angelic language or the heavenly language or the language of the Holy Spirit, though you may not understand it. Though you may not understand it, but God gives that gift. I've seen so many people who have the gift of tongues. They keep praying for hours together in gift of tongues. They don't get tired at all. Suppose if we pray for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, it's so boring. Some people get fed up. But people who are anointed with gift of tongues, they speak the heavenly language, the language of the Holy Spirit, hours, hours, and hours. So this is amazing gift. So on the day of Pentecost, the apostles and Mother Mary and other people, all who are there waiting for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, as I told you, the fire came upon them in the form of tongues, and they spoke in tongues. And which language did they speak? They did not speak angelic language. They did not speak any heavenly languages, but they spoke the human language. You can read in Acts chapter 2, and so many people came from different background, people who were from different country, because on the day of Pentecost, Mother Mary and apostles, all the people, they were praising God so loudly. So people who heard this noise, they all came to see what's happening here. And they spoke in different human languages, and all the people who came from different country, Bible say, they understood in their own language. Amazing. Amazing. We cannot understand all languages. We cannot study all languages. And there was one cardinal in Vatican, Cardinal Lourdes Swami. He knew 16 languages. He can read, he can write, and he can speak. Amazing, is it not? Knowing 16 languages. Even some of you have the worldly languages, very good. And I know about 6 languages, but I preach only in 4 languages. But whichever the country I go, I learn that particular language of that country, about 20 lines, just to lead the people in praise and worship. So language is very, very important. More than that, heavenly language is important. So my dear brothers and sisters, when you get the gift of tongues, and you'll be able to speak in one of these languages. But one thing, let me tell you, this is a gift. If you have the gift of tongues, praise God, worship God, amazing, spend time. But if you don't have the gift, don't practice it, because somebody is talking in some gift of tongue and you don't have to practice it. No, the gifts cannot be practiced, because I have seen some people. Because some people are speaking in tongues, and the person who doesn't have gift, he feels humiliated and he will also do some sound. No, please don't do that. Ask the Lord, Lord, I'm thirsting for the gift of tongue. Bless me. You may get it. Okay, now let me go to gift of interpretation. What is this gift of interpretation? So gift of interpretation is this. When you speak in tongues, you yourself cannot understand what you are talking. Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, you can read 1 to 4, and gift of tongue is for the personal edification. And if you have the gift of interpretation, you can interpret. And if you don't have gift of interpretation, when you are in a crowd, don't keep on speaking gift of tongues, because people may not understand what you are talking. So gift of interpretation is that whichever the gift that you have, you speak in the human language or the angelic language, a person who has got a gift, he will understand. And he will tell in his local language, whichever the language they speak. So people will be able to understand. This is very, very important. Once when I've been to Russia, I was giving a retreat very close to Moscow. And you know, I did not have a proper interpreter. He could not interpret properly. And I knew, and he knew, and the people also knew. But somehow there was no any other option. He was managing. And towards the end of the retreat, many people said, "We don't know English, but we understood whatever you preached in our Russian language." Amazing that is. Even today, Jesus is the same. Yesterday, today, forever. Whatever happened on the day of Pentecost, people were able to understand in their own language. Even today, the same miracle can take place. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, interpreting the gift of tongues. And also the gift of interpretation is interpreting the vision, interpreting the dream. Many times God can give you certain dreams or vision that you may not understand. For example, Genesis chapter 41, you can read, Pharaoh had a dream. And that dream was of the kingdom. And he did not understand. And Pharaoh invites all the wise men, all the people who believed in evil spirits. He invites all the people who believed in black magic and people who had worldly wisdom, knowledge. And Pharaoh says, "Come on, tell me, what is the meaning of the dream?" Nobody was able to interpret. And Joseph comes, a man of God who had anointing of the Holy Spirit, and he interprets the dream. That is the gift of interpretation. In the book of Daniel chapter 5, you can read. Again, there the king, he sees an handwriting. Mene, Mene, Tekel, Parson. He could not understand, what is this? What is this? And nobody was there to interpret that except Daniel. Because Daniel was a man of God, anointed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yes, gift of interpretation is very, very important, brothers and sisters. If you don't have the gift of interpretation, you may have the gift of vision or gift of dream. But if you don't have interpretation, you may interpret in a wrong way. And that will create confusion. So we have to be very, very careful. So next, I'm going to gift of prophecy. And the gift of prophecy in Numbers chapter 12, verse 6, God says, the Bible says, God speaks through dreams. God speaks through vision. Oh, praise the Lord. God will speak to his people, especially to the prophets, through dream, through vision. Sometimes you can hear the voice of God. Sometimes you can hear or hear the voice of God in your heart, an inspiration. Amazing. Many times in my ministry of 42 years, I have received this, God giving me messages through dreams and vision. I have heard the voice of God many times in a difficult situation, not all the time. Not all the time. When in very difficult situation, oh, I hear the voice. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, prophecy is very, very, very important. You can receive that. I can receive. Anybody can receive it. Prophecy is a gift. But one thing I want to tell you, some of you who have already have the gift of prophecy, that is only for the glory of God. Don't misuse it for your personal name, personal fame, personal glory. No, the gift of prophecy is only for the glory of God. Don't use it for your name, fame, or money. No, that's too dangerous. That's why in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23, verse 9 to 40, you read, God talks about the false prophets. And God said, these people prophesy in my name, whatever is in their mind. God is not talking. But what is their mind? And they will say, as a prophecy. Even the evil spirits can give thoughts to people, and they will prophesy. And the end of that prophecy will be only problem, people moving away from God, destruction. So we should be very careful about prophecy. If you have the gift of prophecy, praise God, but you need to discern the vision, discern the dream, discern the inspiration. Whatever comes into your mind, don't tell it away. It says prophecy. I've seen in some places, some people say, all those who have got gift of prophecy, now come on, prophesy. And everybody, whatever comes in their mind, they keep on talking. And they don't like some people, and for their sake, if that person is there in the group, and they will tell something what is in their mind in the name of prophecy. No, brother, please don't do that. No, sister, don't do that. Gift of tongues, gift of interpretation, gift of prophecy is only for the glory of God. It's only for the glory of God. We have to be very, very careful when we receive these gifts and when we operate these gifts. The prophecy can be for an individual, for a prayer group, for a diocese, for the country, or for the whole world. You read the book of Isaiah, what a great man of God. Every time he used to pray, oh, God is to reveal many things to him. He was one of the prophets. He spoke about the coming of Jesus. Of course, every prophet has brought messages of Jesus. But this Isaiah 7:14, you can read. He says in 7:14, a virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. Praise God for that. And Isaiah chapter 53, how Jesus will be crucified. How he will die. What kind of death Jesus is going to have. And look, read Isaiah 43. What a prophecy is that? The book of Revelation, you read. Gospel of John, that is John, Saint John. And God gave that prophecy. Book of Revelation, the last book in the Holy Bible, is nothing but the book of prophecy. And God revealed what's going to happen in the last days. You read the book of Revelation. So prophecy is very, very important. Don't use it if you have that gift for the personal gain or financial gain, for your glory. No. And you have to, with all your, if you have these gifts, humble yourself more and more and more. And now let me go to the next group, divine revelation. The second group, under this divine revelation, as I told you, the gift of knowledge, the gift of wisdom will come, and the gift of discernment. So what is this gift of knowledge? So gift of knowledge means we have divine knowledge and also the worldly knowledge. There are two different things. There are certain people in this world, they have so much of worldly knowledge, but they lack divine knowledge. Divine knowledge comes from God. Worldly knowledge comes from books and media. Divine knowledge leads a person to have fellowship with God, to come away from sin, to come away from devil, to repent and to lead a holy life. So that's the divine knowledge. But the worldly knowledge can take us away from God. Take us away from God. Look at today's worldly knowledge coming through the internet, coming through media, social media, all sinful things. All sinful things. This is the worldly knowledge. So the heavenly knowledge can reveal the past, the present, and the future. Past, present, future of a person, of a family, of a prayer group, of a diocese, of a country, of the whole world. It can be. For example, you read Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 18 to 20. You know, the Samaritan lady came to Jesus Christ. You read the chapter. I'm not going to explain everything. And this lady was trying to tell all kind of lies. One side. On the other side, she was telling, oh, I know how to pray. Oh, we know that Messiah is going to come. You know, she was talking many things, religious things, worldly things. And Jesus said, but she was thirsting for the living water. Jesus said, okay, I'll give you the living water. Go and call your husband and come. She said, I don't have an husband. I don't have an husband. And she is used to tell this lie to for many men. And Jesus, who knew the past of that lady, the present of that lady, the future of that lady, and Jesus said, I know that you don't have husband. You had five. You are living with the sixth now. Oh my God. She was shocked. She was shocked. That was the end of her sinful life. She became the follower of Jesus Christ. So Jesus knew her past, knew her present. My dear brothers and sisters, I can pretend myself to be a very good man, holy man before you and before the whole world. You can pretend, you can focus yourself as a very good person, but I and you cannot pretend before God because He knows our past. He knows our present. He knows our future. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, this is the gift of knowledge. Gospel of John chapter 1, verse 47 to 50, you read, and there we see about Nathanael. Jesus spoke about Nathanael, and Nathanael was shocked. How do you know my name? When did you see about me? Because Jesus was revealing many things. Yes, that's the gift of knowledge. Let us take St. Peter, the first pope. You know, when Jesus was telling that everyone will forsake, I'll be arrested, I'll be crucified, everybody will run away from me. You know what Peter said? Oh, Jesus, I will never forsake you. I'm ready to give my life to you. But Jesus said, you will deny me three times before the cock crows. That means Jesus knew what is going to happen in Peter's life. So brothers and sisters, gift of knowledge is very, very important. So if you have this gift of knowledge, you can deal in your personal life, in your family life. Because many problems come in personal life, family life, a prayer group, because we don't know what to talk, what not to talk. The moment we open our mouth, we will lose our temper, talk whatever we want, whatever comes in the mind. If you have the gift of knowledge and wisdom, just one word, you can solve the problem. I come to the wisdom now. Divine wisdom come from God. Worldly wisdom come from experience, book or media. For example, what to say or what to do in difficult situation. You know, there are times in our personal life, family life, business life. Problem with the children, problem with the wife, problem with the husband, problem in the prayer group. We don't know what decision to take, what to say, how to handle the problem. But if you have this gift of knowledge and gift of wisdom, I tell you, within split of a second, you can solve the problem. Split of a second. For example, you take Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 3 to 11. Pharisees and Sadducees, they wanted to find fault with Jesus. All the time they're finding some fault, but they could not find. And once they caught hold of a woman who she was caught in the adultery, red-handed, and according to the law of Moses, she must be stoned to death. And they caught this lady. They brought to Jesus. Jesus. Now this woman was caught red-handed. In the case of adultery, the law of Moses says, stoned to death. Now what do you say? Brothers and sisters, if I were to be there, you were to be there, or anybody would have there, what answer we can give? You know what Jesus said? Come on, throw the stone, stone her to death, but the one who has not committed the sin, let him throw the first stone. This is called the gift of knowledge, gift of wisdom. Let him throw the first stone. And maybe some of them, they thought, oh, I am a very holy man, correct man, perfect person. I will throw the first stone. You know what Jesus was doing there? He was writing something on the ground. What was he writing? Was he writing A for apple, B for ball? No. What I feel, maybe people were standing in front of Jesus and Jesus could read their heart and mind because they were thinking they're perfect, they were honest. And Jesus was writing their sins. Hey, you fellow, you have committed so-and-so sin and so-and-so date and so-and-so year. Oh, that fellow ran away. Second fellow comes to throw the stone. And Jesus would have written, hey, you fellow, you are the fellow who slept with that lady and so date. That fellow ran away. So every person was thinking he was perfect. Jesus was writing their sins and everybody ran away. Everybody went away. And nobody could stand perfect before God. And now Jesus was the only perfect person there. Only he has the right to stone her. And you know what Jesus said? Go in peace. Do not sin anymore. Because of your sin, you have come to this situation. Go in peace. Do not sin anymore. Brothers and sisters, what a wisdom, what a knowledge. All the people who came to punish her, they all went away. So we need these kind of wisdom, these kind of knowledge. For example, when Jesus was tempted in Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4, verse 1 onwards, if you could read, devil tempted Jesus in many ways. Look at the answer Jesus gave. I'm not going to explain all those things. Look at the answer that Jesus gave. Even devil could not do anything. He gave right answers, especially from the word of God, from the Holy Bible. You read Matthew chapter 4, Luke chapter 4, and you will come to know. So my dear brothers and sisters, word, that is the gift of knowledge, gift of wisdom, I will tell you one more example for you to understand. The gift of knowledge, gift of wisdom is like finding out sickness in a person and giving a right medicine. You go to a doctor and the doctor can do all kind of scannings or tests, whatever it may be, and he will find out what is the real sickness. And he will give the right medicine. And thereby, his sickness is healed. So this gift of wisdom, gift of knowledge can solve your personal problem, family problem, and any problem, problem in the prayer group or in the diocese or in the country. Now there's a big war going on between Palestine and Israel. Look at the way the war is going on. Neither Palestine has a gift of wisdom, gift of knowledge from God. They're only using their army power. But look at the technology. The Palestine has fired more than 3,500 rockets. And most of the rockets were intercepted by the interceptors of rockets. That's the technology what Israel has and what America has. So imagine if 3,500 rockets would have fallen in Israel. Certainly one rocket can take 10 to 50 lives. Okay, let us take one life. 3,500 rockets, if it had taken one life, more than 3,500 people would have dead and gone in Israel. But the intercepted the rocket. Nothing happened. Very few people died. But all the media is showing 200 people died, 250 people died in Palestine because they don't have the technology. That's why the bombs and the rockets are hitting the target and some are getting affected. But if this wisdom and knowledge, if they had, brothers and sisters, the problem would have been solved. The problem would have been solved. Today, every country, every prime minister, every president, every senator, every governor, every government authority, they need the heavenly wisdom, heavenly knowledge, because problems after problems are there. And if they have, they can solve it. They can solve it. And now I move to the discernment, the gift of discernment. What is this gift of discernment? My dear brothers and sisters, one side, the Holy Spirit is working overtime. And the other side, the evil spirit is also working overtime. How do you know whether you are guided by the Holy Spirit? How do you know you are guided by the evil spirit? So if you have the gift of discernment, you can easily make out whether the Holy Spirit is guiding you or evil spirit is guiding you. I give an example. This example the Lord gave me when I was giving a retreat for priests and sisters. You know, usually I give retreat for priests and sisters. The highest number of priests and sisters, the retreat I gave, were 2,000 priests and sisters and 8 bishops. And I was given a topic. I was not the only preacher. I was one of the preacher. 5 days retreat. And I was given the topic. One of the topic was prayer. And when I was meditating, the Lord gave me this insight. That insight I'm going to share with you. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 to 19, if you could read. And there, Jesus was asking the apostles, what is the opinion of the people? What do they say about me? And they said, oh, they think that you are a prophet like Elijah or Elisha. They're dead and gone. And now you have gone in their spirit. You know, many things, what people were saying. Maybe you are like Elijah or Elisha, that and this. But Jesus said, what is your opinion? What do you say about me? You know what happened? Saint Peter said, oh, you are the most holy one, the Son of God, the Messiah who is supposed to come. Amazing answer. You know what Jesus said? Hey, Peter, you did not give this answer. Your answer has come from above. The Holy Spirit has revealed this to you. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters. The Holy Spirit has to reveal many things. Only then it will be right, correct. And now in the same chapter, Matthew 16, verse 21 to 23. Now what happened? So Peter felt, oh my God, the Holy Spirit is guiding me. What an answer I gave. And he was going with Jesus. And suddenly he told Jesus, Jesus, look at the people. Thousands are following you. Why you want to die? You become the king. Jesus turned and looked back. Who is this fellow talking to me? All the way from heaven I've come to die. The heavenly Father has sent me to die for the sins of the whole world. I had to redeem the whole world. If I do not die, there'll be no salvation. But who is this talking to me that I should not die? When he saw, it was Peter who was talking. And when Jesus saw Peter, the evil spirit was guiding Peter. The evil spirit was giving thought to Peter to tell Jesus not to die. Because the devil knew if Jesus dies, whole world will be saved through him. And if he does not die, salvation will not come. Devil knew that. And now, when Peter said that, Jesus saw devil was giving this idea. Just like the devil gave idea to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And what did Jesus say? Satan, get behind of me. Satan, leave Peter and get out. Look at this. Just few minutes before, the Holy Spirit was inspiring Peter. Now the devil is inspiring Peter. And then in Matthew 21, verse 31 onwards, as already I told you, Jesus was talking about his crucifixion and death, and everyone will forsake me. And Peter said, oh no, even if everybody forsakes, I will not forsake. And with what power did he say? It was not with the power of the Holy Spirit, not with the power of the evil spirit, which is evil, willpower. Sometimes we talk many, many things with willpower. We don't keep it up. That's what Jesus saw, that Peter was talking with his willpower, and Jesus knew that he will not keep it up. And Jesus said, before the cock crows, you will deny me. So my dear brothers and sisters, Jesus, the giver of the gift, he had the gift of discernment, so he could make out whether the Holy Spirit was working in Peter, or evil spirit was working in St. Peter, or willpower is working in St. Peter. Or if we have this gift, I tell you, brothers and sisters, your family life will be a small heaven, because no problem at all. Your prayer group will be an amazing group, because you are exercising these gifts. So we need to pray for that. Now, let me go to the third group, the divine power. Under this comes faith, physical healing, and miracles. What is this faith? Usually, you know, Bible says, we need to have faith upon Jesus, faith upon God. This is not the faith which is talking about here. The gift of faith is totally different from the usual faith what you have, I have upon God. The gift of faith. Example, I tell you, when there are certain things, impossible things, impossible, all people in the world have given up. But if the gift of faith operates in you, the power of God will work through you, and impossible things become possible. Example, you read Gospel of John, chapter 11, verse 38 to 44. And you know what happened? Lazarus was dead. He was buried. Almost 4 days is over. And now, Mary and Martha, sisters of Lazarus, they were telling Jesus, it's of no use going to the tomb. He's already dead and gone. His body will be stinking. You know what Jesus said? Even now, if you believe, you will see the glory of God. That means Lazarus is dead, he's buried, but still, if you have gift or faith upon me, you will see your dead Lazarus coming back to life. Praise the Lord. This kind of gift can operate through anybody, because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. In the early days of my ministry, you know, something very strange happened. And the strange thing happened is, one young girl, could be about 20-year-old girl, she was in a deathbed. Doctors have given up hopes. She could not eat, drink even water. She was dying. All the relations of that girl has come. And they were not Christians, okay? They were not Christians by faith. Non-Christian. And I was taken there to pray. So when I saw her, she's almost like a dead body. People are crying. God, even I have no faith now. What can I do? When doctors have given up hope, just for the sake of praying, I thought, let me pray. When I was praying, the Lord told me, continue to pray. She will come back to life. Oh, amazing that is. Lord, doctors have given up hope. Everybody has given up hope. Relations have come. She's breathing her last. But you are telling me to pray? Brothers and sisters, you believe it or not, with all my humility, I am just telling you, I continue to pray, continue to pray. And then finally, I was able to make out there was a very powerful evil spirit in her body That evil spirit was taking her away, taking her life away. And I commanded that evil spirit, and it left in the name of Jesus, and she got up. All the people were amazed to see that. Amazed to see that. So the gift of faith can make all things possible when the world is saying impossible. And this gift is for you, for me, and anybody. And the gift of miracle. Before I say miracle, I go to gift of healing. Only then you can understand difference between healing and miracle. What is gift of healing? Maybe there are type of sicknesses in this world. For example, you have different type of pain in the body, or different type of problems, or maybe a tumor, or something internal, which nobody can see. But when we are praying, that sickness will be healed. Immediately, the tumor is disappeared. That pain is gone. That bone is set right. You know, different kind of healing. But people will not know. Oh, only the person who got healed, they will say, oh, I got healed. The pain has disappeared. Tumor has disappeared. Because nobody can see that. But what is gift of miracles? Gift of miracle is that if a person is blind, everybody knows he's blind. If the person is deaf, everybody knows he's deaf. If a person is crippled, everybody knows he's crippled. If a person is dead, everybody knows he's dead. Now, when you have the gift of miracle, when you pray, the born blind man will see. Oh, people are amazed. The born deaf will hear. People are amazed. The born cripple will start walking, running. People are amazed. The dead people will stand up, get up. People are amazed. These are gift of miracles. And Jesus feeding 5,000 men. Why it is, says men? That means they had their wife, another 5,000. Their children could be 50 or 60,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. That's a miracle. Jesus walking on the water, that's a miracle. Jesus commanding the wind and the ocean, that's a miracle. And dear brothers and sisters, did you understand the difference between healing and miracles? All these 9 gifts is for you. Is for me. Is for everyone who believes in Jesus. You know why? In the beginning I told, these gifts can be received only by the followers of Jesus. There are so many religious leaders in the world from different religion. Nobody can receive this gift. Nobody will have this gift. There will be prayer meetings in every religion. You can never see a blind seeing, a deaf hearing, a cripple walking. You cannot see because they don't believe in God, the Father, Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, the true God. All these gifts are given to the followers of Jesus to prove that there is only one God. There's only one creator, God the Father, Son, Jesus, God the Holy Spirit. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, these gifts are waiting for you, but you have to thirst for it. You have to thirst for it. Simply if you say one prayer or two prayer or 1 day or 2 day, you will not receive this gift. First thing, you need to believe in Jesus. You need to follow Jesus. You need to have the fruits of the Holy Spirit, anointing, and then thirst and thirst and thirst. And then you will get the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Maybe slowly, one by one, one gift can operate from you. Let me tell an example and pray. Once when I was in Japan, to conduct youth conference and also the leader conference. Friend, after all those programs, I was just one day going for an evening walk from Tokyo Park to Tokyo Tower. If somebody has gone to Japan, you'll know what I'm talking about. So from Tokyo Park to Tokyo Tower is a straight road. And even the footpath is straight. You can see about 1 kilometer distance who is coming. So when I was just taking an evening walk, about half a kilometer from me, one young girl, could be 20 or 22 year old girl, she was also coming. That means if I am going towards the north, she was coming towards the south. That means we are coming from opposite direction like this. When I noticed her half a kilometer away, the Lord told me, pray for her. Pray for her. I said, what is this? I'm a stranger here. How can I pray for this girl? I was just thinking, and I was coming towards her. She's also coming now closer, could be less than 100 meters. Again, the Lord said, pray, pray, pray for her. I said, Lord, how can I pray? And almost she came in front of me, and I was in front of her. The Lord said, pray. I blocked her and said, can I pray for you? She was just looking at me. Who is this man? You want to pray for me? And she said, okay, pray. I laid my hands upon her in public road and started praying, Lord, bless her. Fill her with the power of the Holy Spirit. Fill her with the fruits and gifts of the Holy Spirit. Let her become your channel here in Japan. I kept on praying for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. As I was praying, she started crying. And after the prayer, when I opened my eyes, I was surprised to see there were 30, 40 people surrounded us. And I got scared because I'm praying, oh, that young girl, God, what will the people say? I'm a stranger there. But still I asked that girl, as I was praying, why did you cry? She told me, why did you pray over me? So I told her, I don't know who you are, but the Holy Spirit told me to pray for you. So that's why I prayed. Now tell me why you were crying. And that girl told a story, amazing story. She's from a Buddhist background. And 1 year before, from South Korea, somebody had come to conduct a retreat, and one of her Christian friend, she took this Buddhist girl to the prayer meeting, and there she accepted Jesus. And she started reading the Bible. She came to know the truth. And she was praying, Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit so that I can tell the people in Japan about you. Give me a green signal. Should I talk about you? Give me a green signal. Give me a green signal. Anoint me with the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, she prayed for almost 1 year like that. And that girl said, almost 1 year I was praying. Even while coming, I was praying and coming. And you prayed over me. Whatever is in my heart, you prayed over that. That's why I started crying. Amazing. To cut short the testimony, she's talking about Jesus in Japan. So many people are believing in Jesus. So what I want to tell you, you need to thirst if you want the gift of the Holy Spirit. Simply sitting 1 day or 2 day, going to church 1 day or once in a week, Lord, I want the Holy Spirit. Sorry, the gifts will not come. So you need to thirst and thirst and thirst and thirst. And the Lord will see your thirst and give the Holy Spirit. But imagine you don't have the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but still all these miracles can take place through you. James chapter 5, verse 15, if you could read, there the Bible says, the prayer of the faith. Faith means a person who has faith in Jesus, a righteous person, a holy person who doesn't have this gift. But still, when you pray over a person, because of your faith, Jesus can heal that man. Jesus can heal that woman. Jesus can perform miracles. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters. With this, I'm going to wind up and pray. And next week, 26, I'm going to talk what happened exactly on the day of Pentecost. So, we must thirst. Every day we will thirst. Lord, anoint me with the Holy Spirit. Anoint me with the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Anoint me with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Let me receive the fire anointing. You must be a blessing to the people You must be a blessing. Blessing in so many ways, bringing healing, deliverance, anointing, joy, peace, happiness to the people's mind, body, and soul. With these gifts only we can bring joy, peace, and happiness to others and glorify the name of Jesus Christ. Wherever Paul said, wherever Peter went, you know what the people said? These are the people who shook the world. Oh, these are the people who shook the world. They have come to our city. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, I and you should not be a simple, ordinary Catholic or ordinary Christian. We should be the shakers of the world with the power, gift, and fruits of the Holy Spirit. Shall we close the eyes and let us ask the Lord? Lord, with all my humility, I am asking you, please anoint me with the Holy Spirit. Shall we pray? Lord, dear Heavenly Father, I praise you. I thank you. I worship you, Lord. Jesus, you gave the gifts of the Holy Spirit to many people who are thirsting, especially to your apostles, your prophets and saints. Today, Lord, we need this kind of gifts to prove that there is only one God, the creator of heaven and earth. We want to prove that heaven is real, the hell is real. Lord, to prove all this thing, we need the gifts of the Holy Spirit to bring healing, deliverance, anointing among the people. We need these gifts, Lord. Without these gifts, what can we do, Lord? We can be a simple, ordinary Catholic or a Christian, maybe a good person, but we cannot exercise the heavenly power. Lord, I pray for everyone who is online listening to your talk. I pray, let the power of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the fire anointing may come upon everybody, Lord. Not only upon these people who are online. I surrender all the people in this world, everyone who is thirsting for your gifts, everyone who is thirsting for the fruits, all the people. Lord, please anoint all the people in this world. All who are online, anoint them with the fruits and gifts of the Holy Spirit so that people may come to know, or people will come to know the difference between people who follow you and people who don't follow you. Bless them, Lord. Anoint them with the Holy Spirit. And if somebody is sick right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you may heal their sickness. Bless their family. Bless their children. Bless their finance. Meet all their needs, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Heavenly Father, amen and amen.